we've already said.
I thought I wasn't going to do any more Simply Red songs, but it's good to have a new track to sort of sign off the Simply Red story, really, with something that was sort of upbeat and kind of radio friendly. It's a recording of a song by the Moody Blues called Go Now, which was a huge record in the 60s, and we've done a kind of modern treatment of that. So long. It's goodbye to Simply Red and that catalogue, but it's not goodbye to me making new music, because I've been doing it for 20 odd years and it's time for me to sort of move into another direction, and that's what I plan to do. Darling, I'm still in love with you. I've always likened the music to diaries. They're kind of where you are at the moment in time in your career. Starting out with Money's Too Tight to Mention, it was a cover, and the Valentine Brothers that I used to DJ their version, never had a major hit with it. I think it just scraped the top 40. And we thought this was a great song. And it had particular relevance to the era because it was very much kind of like the Reagan-Thatcher era. And the same kind of political and financial ideas, drip-down economics, that whole kind of thing they shared together. I'd just come from living in Moss Side in Manchester for 4 years. I'd been unemployed for 4 years. And, you know, I was pretty at the bottom of the pack, really. And then all of a sudden, we had this hit record, and it happened very, very quickly. And I kind of blinked, and then I was standing on stage in Los Angeles at the Grammy Awards. And it just all seemed so quick, and it was really hard for a northern working class boy to sort of come to terms with such a dramatic change in one's life. I think it took me about 10 years to even get used to it. It's funny, in the beginning of your career position is very, very tenuous, for being a one-hit wonder to having this long-term career. Holding back the years, thinking of the fear I've had so long. We released Holding Back the Years in the UK, and it didn't even make the top 40 in the UK. So we were having success in Europe, in Italy and Germany, and also in the States. And it wasn't until the success of Holding Back the Years in America that it rebounded in America, was reissued, and then made it to number two in the charts. So that was when we became, how do you say, slightly more established within the sort of UK psyche. You think, well, if you're number one in America, you're on top of the world. And that's it. It's like, I felt like Jimmy Cagney on the top of that. I'm top of the world, Ma! You know, it just was magnificent. Oh. Well, I met all these incredible sort of stars and was just living it up, you know. When I was an art student, I became a huge fan of Jack Nicholson in these early movies. Five Easy Pieces and this kind of stuff, The Last Detail. And so Jack Nicholson came to one of the shows, and I saw him he was dancing on a table in the back of this tiny gig with his shades on in the pitch dark. What's he doing with his shades on? You go, well, it's Jack Nicholson, you know. And he invited us for a drink after the show, and he'd just finished making that movie Terms of Endearment. And I'm standing there, I'm thinking, I'm standing next to Jack Nicholson here. This is completely insane. It's like, you want to pinch yourself because you just can't believe it. And that whole era was kind of like that, you know, with being in America. It wasn't real. It means a huge amount to me to have success in Black America, because that's my predominant musical influence. And to work with people like Lamont Dozier and meet Al Green and Stevie Wonder and all these people was an incredible thrill. by the time we came to do A New Flame, we decided this time to record in Montserrat in the Caribbean, which was a very rock star. I also began the first kind of decent relationship, actually, around that time. I'd met a girl in Japan, an American girl, and we started seeing each other quite regularly as you could in the job that we were both in. She was a model and I was a musician, but we'd meet all places all over the world, and New Flame, the song, was really dedicated to her. I was quite proud of that song because it was an original song, and I was getting a lot of heat as just being a bit of a covers artist, because we had If You Don't Know Me By Now on A New Flame, as well as the Barry White song It's Only Love. And they were both hits for us. So to then get a hit with A New Flame as well just made me feel a whole lot better about my songwriting. The original by Harold Melvin is a real production affair, you know, strings in it and horns in it. There's everything in the kitchen sinks in that song. And what we wanted to do was do an almost jazz version of If You Don't Know Me By Now by stripping it down to guitar, piano, bass and drums and vocals. And that's exactly what it was. And it worked because it was a great song. It should be so easy to do. I'm still very proud of that version. We had a number one with it in America. The second one, which was just a dream, and it was a hit all over the world. What good is a love affair when you can't see eye to eye? Oh. Well, this was an interesting time because this was the first beginnings of a real musical division between me and the band. Because with A New Flame, I had a nose for commerciality. You know, I wanted to have success. Right from the beginning, I so wanted to be in a band. I so wanted to be, you know, the next Beatles or the next Rolling Stones or something like that. So I held on to that so preciously and dug it for so long and tried to just delude myself that that was the case. But the truth of it, there was no other songwriter in the band. No member of the band ever wrote a hit song inside that band. And I was deluding myself. You can imagine at the height of the Beatles' success, they had each other, you know. They might have been locked away in hotel rooms, but the four of them were locked away in a hotel room. I was locked in a hotel room on my own, or usually with a few girls, but that's another story. But not as a team, you against the world, you know. So that makes you very, very insecure and strange and you know, quite lonesome in a way. From 85 until 1993, I was pretty much on tour most of the time. You know, we'd been around the world at least five times, you know. So if we did stop, we were recording an album. And then as soon as we finished the album, a tour was coordinated and we were out on the road again. It wasn't until the early 90s that I actually had the opportunity to sort of sit back and go, wow, I did that. Do you remember when I did that? Because you forget that sometimes I've met some really important people, I'd forgotten I'd even met them, you know? It happened to me with Robert Plant. I said, great to meet you. He said, we've already met. And I felt so bad, but because it's all blurred and mad, you don't remember half the time, you know? It's incredible.